into medicine. If you look at the First World War and Second World War, though there was much more bombing and shelling in the Second World War, actually more people died in the First World War, only because medicine was much more developed in the Second World War. Penicillin came about in 43-44, and between 44 and 45, the maximum number of casualties were saved. Although the atomic bombing happened in the Second World War, more casualties, more people died in the First World War from bayonet wounds and sabre cuts, etc., because there were no antibiotics. Similarly, you can expect more from medicine. Mr. Sriram was telling me, tell us what we should do beyond MHC. That's just the most basic way. In my mind, MHC is just like wearing your underwear. You have to wear your clothes on top of that. That's this. Until now, a Six Sigma is impossible. There's no medical healthcare unit anywhere in the world that's got a Six Sigma, because it's impossible to get only one error out of 1 million. It's just not possible, because we're dealing with so many variables. But we are looking at least at increasing the amount of accuracy, making it more accurate. So we're talking about racism. This guy is saying, me a racist, the only race I hate is the one where you have to run. So you need to bring that in. This is what's killing India. Many of us here, or our spouses, and a lot of our workforce people will be suffering from metabolic syndrome, typical of Indians. Metabolic syndrome means if your waist size in India is more than 36, and if you have either sugar or blood pressure or cholesterol or vitamin D is low, you are having a metabolic syndrome. You have a much higher chance of dying of vascular disease than your Caucasian counterpart. Unfortunately, Indians got saddled with this. There's a fabulous reason for that, which came out in National Geographic, that India was a complete desert. Sahara was all completely green. The Thar Desert was most of India, many, many, many millions and millions of years ago, when the whole world was Gondwana land. So what we did was Indians, we incorporated into our gene the gene of a nearby virus which is causing cough and cold, called the adenovirus, called AD36. We incorporated that virus, and because we incorporated that virus, we managed to survive in the desert. How did we survive? Even little food we took, we stored that as fat. And of course, 100 million years ago, we chose to store that fat around our bellies. And that's why you feed an American Red Indian, and an Indian, Asian Indian, same amount of food. The Asian Indian will start developing like Ganesha, whereas the American Indian will not develop that, and the Caucasian won't develop that. So we are, unfortunately, later the desert became green. Now we are having a surfeit of food, and that's dragging us down. So please look at the blood code basics for your people. This is somebody saying, I signed up for an exercise class and they asked me to wear loose fitting clothing, and I said, if I had any loose fitting clothing, I wouldn't have signed up in the first place. So very important slide for you. Do you want to live long? Everyone wants to live long, you know. The Mahabharata, Yamadharma asks Dharma, what's the strangest thing in the world? And he says, beautifully, after a little bit of introspection, although all around us people die every day, we all live as if we'll never die. It's one of the strangest facts of life, and this Ved Vyas telling us that. So anyway, these are some good tips on how you can actually live longer. It's possible that if you all survive until 2025, it's possible that we'll actually be able to start tweaking genes and get people to live to 120 years. Whatever I'm telling you is documented. It's in Science, Nature, highest impact journals in the world. There's a gene called the Methuselah gene. Methuselah, those of you who are Christians here will know, in the first five books of the Bible, the Old Testament, Methuselah lived for more than 120 years. Indeed, he started having kids at 120. You know, amazing. For me, it's bad enough that Abraham started having at 80, but Methuselah started having at 120. Optimist. So you can create the Methuselah gene in human beings, and there's a huge Methuselah program going on. How we can extend life, work, how we can tweak genes, add one hydroxyl moiety here, add one methyl moiety there. But for us, we know that calorie restriction, if you beautifully written in Thirumandiram, the 8th century saint Thirumular wrote, you know, மூன்று வேளை சாப்பிட்டா யூ ஆர் ரோகி, யூல் பி சிக். ரெண்டு வேளை சாப்பிட்றவன் போகி, இஸ் என்ஜாயிங் லைஃப். ஒரு வேளை சாப்பிட்றவன் யோகி, யூ வில் லிவ் லாங். அண்ட் திருமூலர் ஹிம்செல்ஃப் இஸ் சப்போஸ் டு லிவ் ஃபார் 3000 இயர்ஸ். ஈட் லெஸ் அண்ட் லிவ் மோர். தி இந்தியன் அதிதி தேவோ பவஹா, யூ பிரிங் தெம், யூ ஃபீட் தெம் டில் தே டை ஆஃப் ஹார்ட் அட்டாக் அண்ட் தே பிகம் தேவோ. யூ நோ தட் பிகம்ஸ் அதிதி தேவோ பவஹா. யூ நோ பதல் ஹோகே. ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் வாய் ஆஸ் அ ரூல், please make your people this only playing only on Sunday. Let's all go off to beach resort, fully get drunk on Saturday night. You play some games on Sunday, Monday everybody is having a sprain. So next 15 days nobody exercises and they get fatter. you know, that sort of thing doesn't work. Calorie restriction is important. Women and men, women in India will always live longer than men because women tend to have a pear type of obesity, more in the butt and the thighs, whereas men have around the belly. There is that pear type of obesity that it is the reason why every woman everywhere in the world thinks that her butt is very big. It's very good for them because they live longer, on an average 8 to 10 years longer than men. Though of course many people feel that women live longer than men because men are married to women whereas women are married to men. But that's a very sexist way of looking at it. I'm just joking. So one way of, some tips for you to carry home. Being a woman itself gives you an advantage. Starve after sundown. I find all this ulta in the new culture. I find people jamming the pubs. Whether they jam the pubs or not, they jam the Tasmax fully from morning to night. The pubs being jammed at 7 or 8 people eating, if you eat after sundown, your metabolism is different. And if you eat after sundown, it gets stored. Eat as much as you want during the day. Breakfast to dinner. Very important carry home message for you. Have a heavy breakfast because your body will take care of it very easily. Have less at lunch and have least at dinner and you will be like this. All of us, what do? We run for work. So we have little breakfast, little mid for more for lunch, maximum for dinner. Shape also is like a wallaka. So the shape will be according to how you have your breakfast, lunch and dinner. Very important. Drink a lot of hot water through the day. Some data showing that hot water actually helps you to burn. Hot water, hot tea, etc. helps you to burn out what you're having. Prepare plenty of fruits and vegetables. Exercise throughout, not only a walk around the block, but exercise throughout. Female employees, it's my major worry that there is a high incidence, proven, statistically data proven, high incidence of infertility these days in female employees because all female employees are sitting in front of a computer, whether it's in a bank, whether it's in the insurance sector, whether it's in healthcare sector, whether it's in IT sector, you're sitting in front of a computer and a computer, although it might give you all the information, is actually slowly frying you with microwave radiation. You know, you can't wear a space suit and sit in front of a computer, but there are some ways of getting past that. And that's why there's an increasing incidence of cancer breast, increasing incidence of cancer cervix. And what happens is, one thing on one side you're getting radiated, on the other side you're increasing your high fat diet. You know, I don't see any old lady selling, you know, buttermilk in the IT parks. It's all KFCs and Burger Kings and McDonald's and all these things which are so loaded. I must tell you, if you stop going to them, you don't need to come to doctors. There's a massive whole-scale poisoning. There's poisoning. I asked when I had dinner with Sachin a few years ago, some close friends, and we asked him only one question and he laughed and refused to answer that. I said, so your children drink Pepsi? He laughed and didn't even answer. It's very obvious. His wife's a doctor. Many of my friends are very close to her. They don't take, none of those stars who say dil mange more and drink Pepsi, none of them are taking Pepsi and Coke. They make sure the children don't take Pepsi and Coke. But you and I are looking at them and we're drinking that and we're killing ourselves and we're killing our children. That is the greatest killing in the world. Not, you know, anything else. Finally, some significant issues. Please try to avoid doing night shifts in women because, last two slides, don't worry. My father used to always quote Bernard Shaw and say, if you're a good speaker, the good speech must be like the length of a woman's skirt. George Bernard Shaw famously said, it should be long enough to cover the subject, but short enough to be interested. So, my dad also used to tell me this, my dad. So women who do night shifts, what happens is when you do night shifts, your rhythm changes. And when your rhythm changes, your hormones change, and because of that, it causes infertility. So one simple move you can do from tomorrow is try to move all the women to one shift. You either work them a day or you work them at night. Don't make them work a day and a night. You keep shifting, you jack their pineal glands, P-I-N-E-A-L glands, and that causes issues. Preferably, it's better for women to work during the day and not at night. So this infertility is a major, major issue, and you find people are spending lakhs and lakhs and lakhs on getting fertile. All they need to do is eat well, exercise well, not expose themselves to radiation, not do night shifts, and you'll get pregnant. I was telling one lady, you know, you're doing night shifts, your husband is doing day shifts. Unless you're together, how are you going to get pregnant? Then you're complaining of infertility. First of all, you be at home together. Get out. You know, it's ridiculous. You work different shifts and you say, but I'm not getting pregnant. What do you expect, like Holy Mary, Immaculate Conception? Future of healthcare. This is a very important slide because this is the future. I have here with me My brother, who's doing a lot of very, very original work in Bangalore in a company called Cellworks that works on something called proteomics, genomics. These are going to be the future. If, for example, Mr. Vasant Krishna came to me with a little bit of pain, 5 years from now, I would do a quick gene study on him, which would give me, in 2 hours, I would know whether an attack of appendicitis would really become serious in him or not. If he is the sort whose appendix is more likely to burst, then I would say, sir, let's knock off your appendix right this minute. If his gene said, no, can wait, I say, you go for your board meeting, take these antibiotics because you are DRW1 positive, DW3 negative, you can still have it in 10 or 15 days. This is called customized healthcare. You know, people going and coming out of all these hair lounges, one fellow's hair is going up like this, one is going like this. I know, it's very customized these days. If you can customize a hairstyle, you can customize, I find people wearing jeans as if a bunch of rabid dogs have attacked and torn various parts off. They ask him, it's new, uncle, you know, it's brand new. I ask him whether the dogs are new or the jeans are new. But whatever, it's his problem, but it's customized. When you can do that, customized healthcare is just at the horizon, it's coming in. And you can do that. Genomics, you can study your genes, you may be 40. You can study your genes and very, very soon you can know that by 50 you will have type 2 diabetes. By 53 or 54 you will have cholesterol. By 58 you will have triglycerides. Therefore, alter your diet accordingly. You are not going to get anything. In that case, you can have your double sundae and your devil cake. So this is happening. Do not think it's a mere fantasy or science fiction. You know, when we started stem cells, many people are thinking, oh, stem cells, is it a gimmick, is it this, that. Last year, somebody in US, the trachea was burnt out. Trachea is the windpipe. They took the patient's own stem cells, reconstructed the complete trachea and just fitted it in. I tell you, in 5 years or 10 years, nobody will have liver transplants. I was part of the first liver transplant in India in 1995. Great moment for me, December 24th. But I can tell you, in 5-10 years, there'll be no liver transplants. You just give a few of your cells, they can cook like cookbook recipe, like Chef Damo. You can cook a liver and say, well, here's your liver, here's your kidney. They've already started doing it. So, spare part medicine, it's called spare part medicine. Genomics, where you look at your genes and you can say, you have this gene, therefore, if you have TB, you will not respond to this and this and this antibiotic, respond to this antibiotic. It's not very far off, and we hope to be able to bring another version of it. What I would like you all to concentrate on are also the last two lines. For example, I know that Anand and group at Cellworks, they're working for to kill tuberculosis by looking at how we can beat TB resistance by tweaking the genes. Anti-aging and anti-dysmetabolic procedures, they are really, really completely possible. Anti-aging, let me tell you something very simple you can carry home. You're in bed, make sure you turn onto your stomach and stretch yourself up like this. Anything that causes extension of the spine is an anti-aging. Anything that causes flexion of the spine is pro-aging. That's why as people become old, they don't become like this, they go like this. And that's why simple asanas, like the bhujangasana, no? It's like in the push-ups, you lift up like this, the bhujangasana. It's anti-aging. It's all given in the kundalini. It's given in so many of the shastras, the Brahma shastras. It's all there that you can actually, the age at which an Indian person should die is actually 110 to 120. By toxically poisoning our minds, poisoning our brains, poisoning our bodies, and poisoning our flesh, we are bringing it down to 70. And it's possible by adopting the right practices, you can do very good anti-aging. There are drugs for anti-aging. You know, women feeling sick and angry and, you know, at perimenopausal, you know, they say, what's the difference between Al-Qaeda and a woman perimenopausal? Answer is, you can negotiate with Al-Qaeda. You cannot negotiate with perimenopausal women. You can negotiate with them if you correct them by giving them the right mix of steroids. Why do you want to let them suffer? It's all, everything in the body is just a small chemical tweaking. You fall in love, it's chemical tweaking. You get angry, it's a chemical tweaking. Everything is neurochemistry and is therefore possible. The last line there is anti-dysmetabolic procedures. Don't get confused by that. This is one of my pet areas where we operate on people and make them non-diabetic, non-hypertensive, bring their cholesterol to normal, make them lose weight. Many people will say, oh, this, maybe there's some side effect. Immediately they'll start thinking. But 10 out of the top 10 cabinet ministers, 3 people, who I personally know, have had this. Nitin Gadkari, Venkaiah Naidu, and now Arun Jaitley. They've all had it. All of them have reversed their diabetes. all of them have reversed their blood pressure. All of them have got normal cholesterol and triglyceride, and they all lost 15 to 20 kilograms. I believe it's a fantastic operation for people who have already gotten there. But for the rest of you and for the rest of your workforce, this is what I would like to push. By using all these and by using the seminars like these, you can avoid getting there. But if you've already gotten there, then you need us surgeons to sort it out. So what should you do? First of all, you please believe in doctors. You know, healthcare in India, many of you know because you're dealing with the healthcare reports and records of people in the US, is dismally low. I've visited several African countries who are among the poorest countries in the world, Rwanda, Burundi, Namibia. Even there, the healthcare is at least twice as expensive as India, and that's why all of them are flooding in. What's going to happen? Look at the last slide. Medical tourism is going to threaten to dislodge local clientele. In 5 years, according to my readout, you want to get a room in a hospital, they'll say, sorry, or somebody from Oman is sitting there, or somebody from Saudi is sitting there, whose billing is going to be four times as much as you, who won't crib like you, who won't hustle like you, so please go away. They're going to start saying, so best way is prevent sickness. Don't fall sick and then be corrected. What you don't want to do is to come to us after you fall sick and then to go to them for insurance. They're also happy if you take insurance and if you don't use it. We're also happy. There are a zillion other ways of making money. We don't want to operate on sick people. Who gets pleasure by cutting off feet? Who gets pleasure by cutting into people's bellies? Who gets pleasure in removing somebody's colon and giving them a permanent colostomy? Not us. And if there is any kind of feeling that there is, that a feeling among medical personnel, that is totally wrong. So believe, number one, discuss with your doctors. In many of your centers, we have our doctors. You can discuss with your doctors, so-and-so has got this, what can be done about him? Not, in my mind, the healthcare that's practiced today in India is, that's not the way to do it. We need to do well before. Customize medicine. Execute healthcare. Simple things like checking your vitamin D, mammograms for women above 40, pap smears, checking homocysteine levels for men with bellies, insulin levels. We will help you. At any point of time, we are very, very glad to help you with that. Follow up. Medicine, like anything that you do, is an iterative process. I'm sure you leave out your people, you just go to the public at large. 100 out of 100 people have insured their motorbikes. 100 out of 100 people have insured their cars, their scooters. 100 out of 100 people have insured their bloody washing machines. But only 17 out of 100 have insured their own bodies. I cannot understand that. And in India, insurance healthcare, Mr. Vasant Krishna will tell you, is ridiculously low. It's ridiculously low. You pay 3,000, 4,000 rupees a year and it covers you for 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs or something. Whereas they'll buy Pongal sweets, Deepavali clothes for that much. I can't understand that. So follow up, it's an iterative process. You have to be at it over and over again. Remember, healthcare in India is very, very low. Medical tourism threatens to dislodge local clientele. I'm sure some of you will have questions. Rudyard Kipling very famously said, 5 friends who have helped me hold my head up high are who, what, where, when, and why. If you ask questions, you get answers and you learn. I would like to thank Shriram, Shyam, Senthil, Mr. Basant Krishna, and my good friend Sujit, who as usual organizing everything from the back, for having brought me here to interact with you. And if you have any questions over the next few minutes, I'm very, very happy to take them. Thank you all for not sleeping. Those of you who slept for not snoring, it's been great talking to you.